So hello, welcome to the University of Aberdeen Aviation and Space Medicine Society's third event in the Introduction to Aerospace Medicine, Aviation and Space Medicine lecture series. Today we have the wonderful Maia Gummer talking about aviation medicine, which is going to be wonderful. This talk will be recorded. So for that reason, I would ask that if you have any questions at any point throughout Maia's talk, just fire them into the chat, and at the end we can go over them and have a bit of discussion. And I think there's a couple of other members of the Paraboladies here as well to chip in if needed. So, lost my button. So yes, we have Maia today talking about aviation medicine. She has a BSc in Human Sciences, and like the other Paraboladies, has an MSc in Space Physiology and Health, and was even an officer in the Royal Air Force. But I'm sure she's going to tell us a little bit more about that in 2 seconds. So, Maia, without further ado, I hand over to you.
Thank you. I'll just share my screen. Is that all good? Just asking the classic question that everyone asks. Yeah, basically, hi everyone. I hope you're all doing really well. It's a pleasure to be here entertaining you all in lockdown. Today I'm just going to sort of run through the basics of aviation medicine. As you can expect, there's quite a lot of overlap with the other lectures in this series, but I've really tried to just pick out the key concepts for you because this is a subject that I love. It's super interesting, and I hope this presentation convinces you so. I've included my favourite aircraft on the title slide here, so the Typhoon, the Chinook, the Osprey, and the Atlas, which I think sort of summarizes the real range and variety of the aviation environment. So Adele gave me a quick introduction, but I'll just go into a little bit more detail. Ironically, I'm not a medic, but I've had a lot of exposure to this area of medicine, which sort of started in my final year at UCL, where I did a module in space medicine and extreme environment physiology, which I think is the world's only undergraduate module on these kind of topics. It was run by Dr. Kevin Fong and Dr. Dan Martin. So we really had like top experts teaching us on this, and I loved it. And this is where I met Eleanor, who's talking to you next week, and became part of the Paraboladies. So I was doing a BSc in Human Sciences, which is a bit of a weird degree. It's sort of an interdisciplinary one, focusing on all the issues surrounding humans. So everything from like genetics to politics, but this was really the module that just captured my attention and led me to pursue my MSc in Space Physiology and Health at King's, and I graduated from this in August, and it was just the most incredible year. And then in the meantime, throughout like all of this, I was working part-time for the RAF as officer in charge of flying on the University of London Air Squadron, and this has huge benefits for students, but particularly those interested in medicine, because it gives you great exposure to military doctors and also first-hand flying experience. So you do like aerobatics, solo flights, navigation and more, and really experience the physiological effects that aircrew go through. And I'm sure you'll agree that understanding and sort of having empathy with your patients will really help you as a doctor to just go the extra mile. So my master's dissertation really just drew on all of this knowledge. It was quite a broad topic, investigating physiological monitoring and how it can be used to identify hypoxia in aviation relevant scenarios. And by that, I mean in combination with acceleration, thermal stress and more. So a lot of that stuff I'll cover this evening will surround that. I thought I'd put in a little video just to get everyone warmed up. I'm a bit of a plane nerd myself, so I just thought I'd include this. It's an F-16 pilot called John Waters, and he just posts really cool videos, so I thought I'd share.
Help the kids. Help the kids. Got your words right. Always knew what to say enough. Fast to get us now.
I hope that sound wasn't like horrendous for anyone else, but it's quite bad for me. So he flies an F-16, which, as you can guess, is like a kind of fast jet, and just post really cool videos. So give him a follow if you want. I promise this isn't sponsored. So we can define aviation medicine. It's quite a broad topic. I know that this is something that is quite confusing for most people, me included. But generally, aerospace medicine encompasses both space and aviation medicine, and is defined by the Joint Royal Colleges of Physicians Training Board as the study of all factors affecting the human body in flight, in health as well as sickness, and the means by which those flying may be protected against the potentially harmful effects of their abnormal environment. However, the lines between aviation and space medicine are really quite blurred. So there's something called the Kármán line, which is drawn 100 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. And this is like a hypothetical boundary between outer space and the Earth's atmosphere. And this is based on a calculation by a physicist called Theodor von Kármán. And he concluded that above this, the atmosphere is too thin to support flight. So by this reasoning, we should define any flight below this as aviation medicine and anything above as space medicine. And generally, this is pretty universal, with the exception of the US, who define space at 80 kilometers or 50 miles above the Earth's surface. And by this logic, Virgin Galactic and other forms of suborbital spaceflight are space medicine. But as I mentioned, this contradicts other more widely held views that the aircraft must breach the Kármán line to be considered a part of spaceflight. So it really is quite, the lines are quite blurred, but I hope that sort of gives you a better idea about what aviation medicine actually is. I thought I'd also just run through the different types of aircraft. Generally speaking, there are three different types of aircraft. You have fast jets, helicopters, and multi-engine planes, each of which provides a different physical environment, and it stimulates different physiological changes and medical requirements. I've included a sort of rough number of the people that can be carried on board. Fast jets generally carry the least people because they need to be sort of light and agile when performing sharp turns, aerobatic maneuvers, and picking up speed, like the clue's sort of in the name. And these are the most commonly used in the military. Helicopters are used in both civilian and military environments, and generally the military aircraft can carry large numbers of people due to their operational requirements of sort of transporting troops. And the people on board will always include a pilot, believe it or not. And there may be any number of passengers or other air crew, such as whiz ops or weapon systems operators in the back. And finally, we have multi-engine aircraft, which are used in civilian life for international flights with vast numbers of passengers, particularly cozy if you're lucky enough to fly with Ryanair. And similarly, these can be used to deploy troops on operations to Afghanistan, the Falklands, etc., or to transport equipment, aid, and supplies to war zones or places in need of humanitarian support. If we were to get into the different medical and physiological considerations of these, I'd be talking for hours, which is fine by me, but I thought I'd summarize a key physiological stressor for each type of aircraft, bear in mind. So the biggest environmental factor distinguishing the aviation environment from sea level is the change in atmospheric pressure. And this falls progressively with altitude, from 760 millimeters of mercury at sea level to approximately half that at 18,000 feet. And it depends on the type and operational requirement of an aircraft, but it will operate at different altitudes, and this can vary hugely. And so I've just sort of included the general ceiling height of each type here. So helicopters usually operate below 10,000 feet. Multi-engines generally operate higher since they're usually pressurized on the inside and travel far distances. Fast jets are generally slightly higher than this, as the aircrew on board can have pressurized suits and administered oxygen. But again, this varies hugely, with the U-2 aircraft even reaching up to like 70,000 feet. And then, as mentioned, we have suborbital spaceflight vehicles. Forgive the rather animated image here, but these generally apogee just above 80,000 feet. Gas density falls nearly exponentially with vertical distance, so the partial pressure of oxygen in the ambient air is vastly reduced, meaning aviators experience a fall in oxygen consumption and therefore receive an inadequate oxygen supply to the body tissues in either molecular concentration or quantity. And this stimulates a number of physiological changes, some of which are highlighted here. Many types of demands are placed on a pilot during flight, depending on the occupational requirements of the aircraft, the physical loads placed upon the pilot, and the different skills required during various flight activities. So I'll start with the respiratory concerns. A fall in the oxygen tension of inspired gas is known to reduce alveolar oxygen tension as influenced by alveolar carbon dioxide tension. And above 10,000 feet, alveolar oxygen tension decreases to a level that induces an increase in respiration by stimulating carotid and aortic body chemoreceptors, raising alveolar ventilation and reducing alveolar carbon dioxide tension. This increase in respiration then feeds back and reduces the rate of decline in alveolar oxygen tension, and this is known as the respiratory depressant effect. Thus, a compromise is sort of made between the demand for an adequate oxygen supply and the maintenance of an acid-base balance, which exhibits significant individual variation. The diffusion gradient from the alveolar gases due to the pulmonary capillaries is notably reduced upon altitude exposure, with pulmonary oxygen tension nearly equaling that of the alveolar gas at rest. So in terms of cardiovascular concerns, the reduced oxygen tension of the inspired gas induces a number of cardiovascular changes, including general and regional blood flow alterations. And this is really the main factor determining the level of oxygen tension delivered to cells. So in hypoxia, blood flow is redistributed to acutely essential organs. For example, cutaneous and renal blood flow is notably reduced, while skeletal muscle, cerebral and coronary blood flow increase markedly. At 15,000 feet, the resting heart rate is approximately 15% above the sea level resting value, with a proportional increase in cardiac output since stroke volume remains sort of largely unchanged. And this is also the case with mean arterial blood pressure, which is essentially unchanged, although systolic blood pressure is generally increased and there is a decrease in total peripheral resistance, stimulating an increase in pulse pressure. Coronary blood flow also increases proportionally with cardiac output to meet the myocardial metabolic demands, to the extent that even an individual breathing air at 25,000 feet exhibits no ECG evidence of cardiac hypoxia. However, severe hypoxia at extreme altitude can cause myocardial depression, which is reflected in ECG with a depressed ST segment as well as a reduced T wave height. In the case of cerebral blood flow, arterial oxygen tension must fall lower than about 45 millimeters of mercury to cause vasodilation and an increase in flow. Above this, flow is exclusively determined by arterial carbon dioxide tension, which has a vasoconstricting influence if reduced. Up to an altitude of around 15,000 feet, therefore, we can expect to see a decrease in cerebral blood flow when breathing air. Pulmonary circulation also undergoes a change in response to significant degrees of hypoxia by vasoconstricting, likely in response to pulmonary vessel chemoreceptor stimulation by oxygen. And when combined with the predicted increase in cardiac output, pulmonary arterial blood pressure rises. So I've spoken a bit about hypoxia. I'm just going to like break that down a little bit more. There are basically three main types of tissue hypoxia in aviation, and these can occur concurrently. Hypoxic hypoxia is the most common and occurs when arterial oxygen tension is reduced, often due to the low oxygen tension of inspired gas, which comes coupled to the altitude atmospheric pressure reductions. Anemic hypoxia develops when the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood is reduced, as is the case with carbon monoxide inhalation, which is a risk in flight when external air flows over the engine and is breathed in by the pilots, because this reduces the hemoglobin binding capacity to oxygen. And ischemic hypoxia is also a risk, and this is a consequence of a tissue blood flow reduction despite normally functioning lung gas exchange and adequate arterial oxygen tension. And again, in aviation, this could be a result of local arteriolar constriction due to cold exposure
or due to a fall in cardiac output or blood pressure if exposed to sort of high sustained acceleration. Frequently concomitant to hypoxia is hyperventilation, and these are two physiological states that really do produce similar symptoms sometimes. In this state, pulmonary ventilation through overbreathing exceeds the necessary amount to remove the body of excess carbon dioxide. And this is characterized by hypercapnia, when alveolar and arterial oxygen tension are notably reduced, and this can significantly diminish the performance of psychomotor tasks or even cause unconsciousness if reduced to approximately sort of 25 to 30 millimeters of mercury. It's a similar story for jugular venous oxygen tension if lowered to 17 to 19 millimeters of mercury, and depends really on the severity of hypercapnia. And this becomes extremely dangerous for aircrew who are performing like mission critical tasks, and they have to remain sort of vigilant and alert. So in terms of neurological changes, mental performance can be notably impaired by hypercapnia through the reduction of cerebral tissue oxygen tension through vasoconstriction and the increase in pH of cerebral tissue. Delirium is frequently seen in hypoxic aircrew, and this is characterized by just an abrupt change in mental status, disorganized thinking, and an agitated state during a period of confusion. Simple reaction times in the performance of psychomotor tasks, for example, is also affected by hypoxia. Alveolar oxygen is generally sufficient enough to maintain adequate performance of practice tasks up to sort of 10,000 feet. But should this fall to 38 to 40 millimeters of mercury, which is about 16 to 18,000 feet equivalent, it can deteriorate depending on the altitude and complexity of the task. More specifically, choice reaction times and performance of pursuit meter tasks are notably impaired beyond 12,000 feet. So all this considered means that the threshold for the adverse effect of hypoxia has arguably been set as low as 5,000 feet. Performance of tasks requiring hand-eye coordination, such as instrument flying, deteriorates by approximately 10% in terms of the pilot's ability to maintain a given airspeed, heading, or vertical velocity. And this reduces even more to 20 to 30% when alveolar oxygen tension is below 40 to 45 millimeters of mercury, which is about 15,000 feet. Neurological symptoms of hypoxia extend to special sense impairment, with many aircrew reporting a darkening of the visual field that becomes significant with an alveolar oxygen tension below 50 millimeters of mercury. Additionally, peripheral vision can be lost, a central scotoma can develop, but symptoms are not limited to visual effects, for auditory acuity is also reduced. And this has particular operational significance for pilots who often have to respond to warning tones. And now for my favourite topic. So this acceleration, the human body is adapted to function in a 1G environment, which is sort of the continuous baseline force of Earth's gravity. Air and spacecraft, however, are capable of generating larger sustained accelerative forces that places a lot of strain on the human body. So there's three axes of acceleration which humans can experience, which is depicted by my guy here in the corner looking super happy. So GX from front to back, GY from left to right, and GZ from head to toe. And GZ is by far the most physiologically intolerable. Most aircrew will be exposed to at least positive 6GZ during their basic flying training, during air combat maneuvering, maximum possible rate turns, and ground attack flights. So I thought I'd include a video to illustrate the effects of this. Essentially, the RAF invited this YouTuber to experience the flying that we do on the Uni Air Squadrons in the Grob Tutor. So this is at RAF Wittering, where London and Cambridge UAS do their training. Basically just pay close attention to their faces and try and imagine the blood flow through the body when they're experiencing the G-force. Just
Sorry about the bleeped out language in that. I helped it sort of, I hope it helped you sort of put into perspective a bit more. And I hope you were able to have a little think about where the blood was flowing. So what he was experiencing there was long duration acceleration, which is anything over like 1 to 2 seconds. And this has a really big effect on hypoxia and is encountered in aerobatic aircraft maneuvering and in the launch and re-entry of space vehicles. So ultimately, this alters the flow and distribution of blood. For example, the hydrostatic pressure gradient of the body shifts to increase pressure below heart level, reducing the blood supply to cerebral and retinal circulations and inducing a number of visual effects, including grey out. So this could be sort of like loss of vision, sort of like spotted, or loss of peripheral vision. And this progresses into blackout, where you're still conscious but you can't see anything, and eventually loss of consciousness. Neurons in the brain are highly dependent upon their oxygen supply, meaning the brain is particularly susceptible to hypoxia when blood loss is reduced by positive GZ acceleration, normally causing a lapse in consciousness within about 5 seconds. Acceleration also distorts bodily organs and tissues. There are changes in lung volume, diaphragm displacement, and pulmonary blood flow redistribution, as well as cardiac dysrhythmias, such as an increase in heart rate. Great variation in G tolerance exists between individuals, and this is primarily dependent on the magnitude and rate of change in acceleration imposed upon the body, which impacts the physiological responses. Hyperventilation reduces an individual's tolerance to positive GZ acceleration, and in aviation, this can be a feature of a poorly performed anti-G straining maneuver, which is a physical maneuver performed by pilots to increase their G tolerance, or it could be due to something like anxiety. And this is because hypercapnia produces greater cerebral vascular resistance, which exacerbates the already reduced blood flow to the brain caused by positive GZ acceleration. If the arterial carbon dioxide tension is reduced below about 25 millimeters of mercury, the threshold for grey out reduces by approximately 0.6 g, and even moderate hyperventilation has reportedly precipitated unconsciousness in subjects exposed to just positive 3GZ. Hypoxia also reduces G tolerance, with several subjects breathing air at 10,000 feet experiencing a blackout threshold 0.5 g lower than otherwise. And this presents a great risk to aircrew training in aerobatic, often unpressurized training aircraft, and they may not have G protective clothing administered to the aircrew flying the really high performance aircraft. Next is thermal. I hope you like my little diagram. This affects the severity of hypoxia in aviation. Aircrew are at risk of both hot and cold temperatures. CO2 and water vapor in the lower atmosphere absorb solar radiation and re-radiate part of this infrared energy to the Earth's surface, whereby it is radiated again. Thus, a warmer environment is created close to the Earth, or closer to the Earth than there would be without the atmosphere. And this is termed the greenhouse effect, which I'm sure everyone here has heard of. The lower atmosphere can therefore present uncomfortably high thermal temperatures, which is an inescapable fact of fast jet aviation. But this threat diminishes with vertical distance and is replaced by dangerously low thermal temperatures. Since humans are homeotherms that must alter their physiology to maintain their core temperature within a narrow range in a wide variety of environments, they need to do so to sort of ensure the enzymes and cells of the body can perform optimally. If the environmental temperature exceeds what an individual can cope with, they'll experience thermal stress, and this can impact upon their performance adversely, potentially threatening operational safety and effectiveness. Combining high performance flying, hypoxia, and thermal stress is not an easy feat, particularly in an aircraft such as a helicopter, which may not have thermal control. Thermal environments can exhibit shared physiological responses, such as increased heart rate in hot, cold, and hypoxic environments. And such an alteration in perception might affect the aircrew's perception of comfort, causing them to attenuate thermoregulatory behaviour and placing them at risk of thermal stress. Next up is visual.
The main eye hazards in flight include empty field myopia, inattention in high speed flight, and blur zones around moving objects seen from the cockpit. So often when you're learning to fly and you're doing a sort of lookout around you, they'll ask you to not move your eyes in one smooth motion, but to sort of jerk them around a little bit so that you have a sort of still gaze. And when you do that, you're more likely to be able to see moving objects, if that makes sense. And the most common colour vision defect is red-green deficiency. Night vision goggles are frequently worn by pilots flying at night. Who could have guessed it? And they provide a slightly reduced visual acuity, a constricted visual field, and a loss of stereopsis. And finally, laser effects to the eyes include corneal surface burns, macular burns, and temporary loss of vision due to glare or dazzle effects. In terms of vibration, another like abrupt subject jump, this is oscillatory motion. It's characterized by its amplitude and its frequency. And the most simple form of vibration consists of sinusoidal vibration at single frequencies. But more often, recorded vibration contains multiple frequencies and either shows repetitive features if it originates from machinery, like the rotor of a helicopter, or random features if it originates from atmospheric turbulence or like a rough road surface just you're about to take off. An object, if linked to a source of vibration through springy material, may exhibit resonance. This means that within a certain range of frequencies, its amplitude of vibration can build up to levels that are greater than the source of vibration with consequent risk of damage. However, at higher frequencies, the springy material serves to like isolate the object from the source of vibration. Springs are widely used to reduce the transmission of vibration at high frequencies, but this inevitably involves resonance at lower frequencies. And using a damper in parallel with the spring reduces the resonant peak, but renders the spring less effective in reducing vibration transmission at higher frequencies. So again, it's quite difficult. A complex vibration can be broken down into its constituent frequencies by the Fourier transformation of time record. And this process yields the vibration spectrum and is important since the response of the body to vibration is dependent on its frequency. And sort of linking back to what we already discussed, whole body vibration can affect visual acuity, particularly for objects within the vehicle, like aircraft instruments rather than the stable external world. At certain frequencies, this may give rise to problems with motion sickness, neuromuscular control, and hyperventilation. And then at higher intensities, there is a risk of damage to internal body organs. And finally, spatial disorientation. So if a pilot is disoriented and they're sort of unaware of the true attitude or spatial position of the aircraft, they are probably disoriented. And this is as much of a consequence of the deceptiveness of the airborne environment as it is of the sensory inadequacies of the pilot. So if you're in a cloud, your visual cues are almost entirely removed. If you were to enter a constant rate turn, when you roll out, you'll often feel as if you're still turning. And with increasing altitude, the external view may become less detailed. So false horizons may be generated by cloud banks or at night by lines of cultural lighting. Flight over snow, sand or water may lead to altitude errors, and the external view may become degraded or lost and require the more demanding task of flying by instruments. So not all pilots possess this skill. It's really quite difficult. And the ones that do often fail to use it at critical moments, preferring to rely on their instincts, which is what you're pretty much taught in the syllabus. The feel of the aircraft really just can't substitute for vision and will inevitably lead to increasing errors, both in roll and pitch attitude, as well as heading. So you cannot fly an aircraft by the seat of the pants, i.e. by non-visual sensations. So I've put in another video because I know this idea can be a little bit less confusing. And there's less dramatic music in this, but hopefully this helps put it into perspective.
Actually, I'm going to do that just for you. Dad, do you feel like we're turning or going straight?
I think we're turning.
Yeah, we're straight now.
It feels like we're turning to the left now.
Yeah.
I definitely feel level right now.
Yeah, we're turning again.
4,900.
A weird feeling.
It's probably worth noting here that the RAF Center of Aviation Medicine actually has a disorientation simulator. So it's like a flight simulator inside, and then it will cloud over and it turns and everything. And it's really fun to have a go on if you get a chance to visit. But yeah, as you can see, the experience of an illusion and spatial disorientation are not the same. A pilot's recognition of an in-flight illusion usually implies their recognition of the potential to be deceived by it. So whether or not they're recognized, illusions of flight are universal, and the most common being the sensation that an aircraft is in level flight when it's not. By contrast, disorientation incidents and accidents are relatively rare. A pilot describing a disorientation incident does not use the term illusion. Like, to them, the error of aircraft orientation was based on a mistaken reality. In 85% of accidents involving disorientation, the pilot was considered to have been unaware of being disoriented up until the point when the accident became inevitable. And unrecognized disorientation remains a serious problem. One of the most common examples are the false sensations of pitch attitude during accelerated flight, which is a manifestation of the somatographic effect. And this can often be identified as the precipitating factor in accidents associated with takeoff into cloud or with the need to abort a low-level flight or to go around following a missed approach. Many of the visual perceptions of aircraft orientation, such as false or sloping horizons, are made more convincing by the absence of non-visual sensations to indicate an error in aircraft attitude. Equally, the force environment of flight can generate non-visual sensations that lead to an incorrect perception of the location or orientation of objects in the external visual scene if they're isolated and lack any visual context. So I've chatted a lot about physiology. You're probably wondering what the concerns are in aviation medicine. The purpose of running through sort of all of that was that if you understand the principles of aviation physiology, it really enhances your understanding of the medicine as well. And so broadly speaking, there are two branches of aviation medicine, which is clinical and operational. For the sake of time, I'm going to skip over operational medicine, but this involves the medical consideration around like pilot selection and training, radiation, aircraft hygiene, and the flight deck and cockpit. So I'll focus on the clinical side instead, which I hope will tie in better to what you're all in the process of studying. And it's a bit of a similar story for this, I'm afraid. So depends how much time you have. These are just a handful of the clinical considerations in aviation medicine, which I've whittled down even more for my sake and yours, and cherry picked these ones to run through today. So as medics, I'm sure you all know hypertension remains a major cause of morbidity in the general population as well as in aircrew. An early diagnosis of hypertension in aircrew requires a high index of suspicion and should warrant the routine use of ABPM in order to provide a robust, proactive and preventative occupational service to this population. Active exclusion of causes of secondary hypertension is imperative in a population who are otherwise quite healthy, like an aircrew population, and a comprehensive cardiovascular risk assessment is mandatory. Lifestyle advice should be given to all aircrew with hypertension, and if unsuccessful, individuals should be treated according to national guidelines and best practice. Consideration should also be given to the aviation environment prior to the treatment of the aircrew. However, many aircrew members will retain an unrestricted flying category following successful treatment as long as regular and thorough follow-up is undertaken. So the second one I was going to cover was respiratory disease. I'm sure most of you have flown commercially at some point, maybe not right now, but you must have realized that the cabin altitude is pressurized, and this is to about 8,000 feet, not to sea level, which is what most people think. So this will likely lead to some degree of hypoxia in all individuals while flying, and it can lead to increased respiratory rate and resting pulse. And these effects are only accentuated in people with respiratory disease. With the exception of ILD patients, patients with oxygen saturations of over 95% whilst on air at sea level will not require supplementary oxygen during normal civilian flight. Most respiratory diseases in a mild form are still compatible with a flying medical category for pilots to continue. Most respiratory diseases, even in a mild form, are usually disqualifying from individuals entering pilot training. Asthma treatment should be aimed at sort of complete control of symptoms. So the use of inhaler, including combination steroids and long-acting beta-2 agonist inhalers, allows excellent control of the majority of asthmatics and a return to flying category. And new, more intelligent auto CPAP machines allow close and accurate monitoring of flying with sleep apnea remotely. And this again allows a return to flying duties for those compliant with appropriate treatment. So in terms of decompression illness, I'm not sure how many of you will sort of like have heard of or understand this, but this is sort of like carrying on with the theme of pressure. This occurs as a result of acute exposure to a reduction in ambient pressure, and it can present in a wide variety of ways and is a clinical diagnosis. Symptoms are thought to be initiated by the presence of gas bubbles in the tissues or circulation. And the first aid treatment consists of breathing 100% oxygen, minimizing physical activity, and increasing ambient pressure, or like sort of descending to ground level to take away that sort of environmental strain. And since this condition occurs predominantly at altitude, so whilst on task, it has implications for both flight safety and mission success. Medication and air crew. So I'm sure you all know that medications include prescription only treatments, over the counter drugs, but then also traditional herbal medicines and homeopathic remedies. The key points of efficacy, side effects, observation, dependency, frequency, route, storage and supply should be considered before prescribing medication to air crew. And this sort of comes coupled to a real understanding of the aviation environment. Herbal and homeopathic compounds may contain ingredients incompatible with flying or prove ineffective and delay the start of conventional treatment. And also the use of antihypertensive, antidiabetic and antidepressant medications in aircrew have all been topics of recent debate and policy change. Moving on to fatigue, the traditional strategy of managing fatigue via sort of hours of service restrictions began long ago, like way at the dawn of aviation. But since those early days, science has essentially revealed that fatigue management requires consideration of more than time on task. So rather than the amount and quality of sleep and the body's circadian rhythms, these are more key factors in the fatigue equation. Furthermore, it has recently been discovered that some individuals are more physiologically resistant to fatigue than others. However, despite the complexity of the fatigue phenomenon, it is possible to effectively manage fatigue with scientifically validated strategies. So crew schedules can be optimized via the combined use of biomathematical models and wrist actigraphic sleep weight tracking. Crew members and schedulers can be better educated about the nature of fatigue and its proper management. And there are a few scientifically validated countermeasures such as pre-flight sleep optimization, in-flight rest breaks, properly managed light exposure and pharmacological interventions, which can offer significant benefit even when duty schedules are less than optimal. Next is infectious disease, which is very apt at the moment. Obviously these are very common and all aircrew and passengers may be affected by an infection related to their travel, and not only is this a risk to themselves but also to their fellow travellers. So public health emergencies of international concern may be declared at very short notice by the WHO, and these may have a significant impact on international air travel since disease control measures may be imposed to limit the disease spread. There is such thing as air medical evacuation of patients with infectious disease, and these can be conducted if required. If there is a sort of compelling clinical need or operational reason to move any patient, then this can be done in the same way as any other medical evacuation, but by utilizing infection control precautions specific to the infectious disease concerned. Infection control in all aircraft should be a standard operating procedure. So basic principles can be applied, including isolation of symptomatic individuals when practical, and the use of simple hygienic measures. Caution does need to be exercised with chemical disinfectants though, because these can damage airframes sometimes. And sort of leading on from what I just said, we have air medical transfer, evacuation and retrieval. And this is really quite an exciting and diverse operational subject. So we can really provide now very high quality care if it's been sort of planned and implemented appropriately. And with the correct sort of staff training and equipment, there are really few patients that can't be moved now. In recent years, air medical evacuation has been shown to reduce mortality and morbidity by following its forward projection of highly capable resources and swift, expedient movement through escalating levels of medical facilities. It has facilitated a reduction in the overall deployed medical footprint. The evolution of air medical evacuation so far has thus changed the way in which medical operations can be conducted. And as I just got up here, they can be defined as primary, secondary, tertiary, or quaternary, depending largely on the status of the receiving hospital. The aircraft used in patient transfer needs to be carefully chosen by operators, depending on the predominant role profile, the geography of the operating area. Like, you could be way in the middle of nowhere in the mountains or in the middle of the desert, and then also the prevalent weather conditions. In a civilian environment, the decision to transfer a patient is really quite multifactorial, and it's influenced by a multiplicity of clinical, financial, cultural and social factors. And these change as the patient is escalated to progressively higher levels of care. The clinical assessment of fitness to fly involves an appreciation of the intrinsic risk associated with that patient's primary pathology, modified by the additional risk associated with the flight environment. So the two really sort of interconnect. And the presence of any specific conditions known to be problematic in the cabin of a pressurized aircraft. So patient transfer should be undertaken in an aircraft consummate with clinical need. Commercial scheduled flights provide many advantages over long distances and can be appropriate even for patients with complex requirements if appropriately planned and resourced. So for all patients where transfer is contemplated, a comparison of the risks and benefits of commercial and air ambulance transfer should be made. So the provision of a C-level cabin in an air ambulance can actually mitigate the risk of transfer for those patients, as discussed in the decompression sickness, may have entrapped gas which would otherwise expand and pose a risk of trauma to surrounding structures. The necessity to move ever more critically ill patients has increased hugely over the past few years, and with this capability in military practice, it's basically developed immeasurably, and this has required the rapid evolution of skills, training and expertise needed to sort of accomplish these highly complex missions. And what has not changed is the requirement for meticulous planning by personnel currently taking care of the critically ill, who have the ability to accurately assess patients and then move them using that skill, experience and expertise. Missions, as has always been the case, must be properly resourced and have robust logistical support. Equipment has to be specifically designed for transfers and must be able to emulate that of the fixed environment. So it must be tested to ensure compatibility with the air environment and to be able to survive and function in that environment. So all of this considered, it's now possible to successfully transfer patients by air who are really at the extreme ranges of physiological tolerance and allow patients such as the critically ill and war wounded access to the highest level of care in their home country. Okay, so the heavy stuff is over now. I hope I've sort of kept your attention over the last hour or so. And luckily Nina covered most of this in her talk, but I just wanted to sort of summarize how incredibly varied aviation medicine is. Your path might loosely follow one of these branches, but each has its own variety of roles, from GPs to specialists, and comes coupled with like travel opportunities and ultimately just really interesting work. Again, Nina would have covered most of this last week, but in case you weren't there, I've just like cherry picked a few things that have really helped me personally sort of develop my understanding and form connections in the field of aviation and space medicine, firstly, just join the Twitter conversation. People are so friendly. They all follow you back and are more than willing to help. So it's a really great source of news in the area, and you can really learn a lot. Secondly, if you join your local university air squadron, which I think for Aberdeen is the East of Scotland UAS or SUS, which from what I've gauged from Eleanor is really quite far from you, which is a huge shame. But maybe look out for like carpool opportunities, because I'm sure there'll be other students, medics and non-medics, that will go to and from the SUS base for town nights. Yeah, not only are these really fun, but they're a great opportunity to like make friends from other unis, do adventurous training, fly, all while getting paid for it. And they offer the opportunities for medics to get bursaries if they choose to join the RAF or the military in general, which is like a huge incentive for many people, because I think it's like a couple of £1,000. Also join UK societies such as the Physiological Society, the Aerospace Medical Association. Like both of these have free or discounted memberships for students. And similar to that, attend conferences and network, listen to podcasts. So my friends just started an aerospace medicine podcast, but there's also like a more general wilderness medicine one. And finally, if you get the chance, intercalate or do some postgrad study at Keynes. Like, I promise this isn't sponsored, but they offer so much expertise in this area. And like these are just a handful of the physiology courses that they do. Sadly, just one at undergraduate level, but the quality of teaching is amazing. And being so niche, they're really quite small courses as well. But yeah, I really do recommend. Here are my references for anyone who cares or wants to look at them, and yeah, happy to take any questions. Sorry that was long.
No, that's absolutely brilliant. I have to admit, I felt kind of bad when I was drawing up the idea for the lecture series, and I gave you the idea of introduction to aviation medicine, because I thought that would be really difficult to do and to separate it apart from traditional space medicine. But I don't feel bad anymore, because you absolutely smashed. That was really, really good. I definitely invite anyone who has any questions for Maia to throw them into the chat and we can read them out. I'm gonna take a moment just to plug the last event in the lecture series, which is same time next week, and that will be our very own Eleanor, who'll be talking about space tourism. Which is a topic that the Paraboladies know very well. And also, hang around to the end of the questions, and I'll post a link to a feedback form into the chat, and you can add your email in there to get a certificate of participation and also to join our mailing list if you haven't already. So, Nina asks, have you ever been an aviation medicine patient? Oh, I feel like there's a story.
Yeah, there is somewhere. So I think Nina loves the story. She brings up a lot. I was flying, and it was actually my last ever flight before sort of coronavirus. So this was in like February. And I think we got to like 4,000 feet, and maybe I hadn't revised as much as I should have done. So I was like, oh God, I'm not going to remember anything what I'm supposed to do. And then we started smelling this gas, and we were like, oh my gosh, that is really, really strong. It was like this smell of like petrol fumes. So boss was like, oh, we've got a fuel leak. We have to like turn around and go back. So we had to like crack open the canopy at 4,000 feet and then like try and land. And then we like pulled back up on the runway, and there was like an A&E ambulance there taking us to like the A&E equivalent of this was all on base, so it was all like really quiet, and they don't really get many emergencies, so they were just on it. And they took our oxygen saturation and our heart rate, and we were both completely fine, but we got banned from flying for 24 hours and then I never flew again.
Really? Oh, no way. Well, a little bit of excitement at least. That's interesting. Sylvia says, thank you for that really amazing talk. You mentioned apogee earlier on, and I was wondering what this was.
Yeah, oh, sorry, I really should have clarified that. It's basically like the, if you understand like a parabolic flight profile, which sort of goes like that in like a curve or an arch, it's basically like the top of an arch. So it's the peak height that that vehicle would reach.
Okay, cool. Cool. And am I right in saying there's the opposite is the, is it the perigee?
Perigee? I don't know, actually. Maybe.
Don't quote me on that. I'm not the aviation expert. Sapna asks, what would you suggest is the recommended pathway for an emergency physician to start with aviation medicine?
This obviously isn't something that I know a great deal about. Like, I don't know the sort of specifics of different types of physicians. It could be possible to sort of get some experience with the air ambulance, which would be a great way to sort of bridge the two together. In terms of like emergency medicine, I have like a strong preference for going into the military as a doctor. I think it's really interesting. You'll find yourself in loads of emergency situations. So that would be my advice on it. I'm not really a big expert on that, I'm afraid.
No worries. They're both very good points. I think bridging the gap with air ambulance is a really good idea. And also just working with the air ambulance is phenomenal. I would kill for an opportunity to do that. We have no more questions at the moment, but I'll leave it open for people to add. I had a question myself.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if you'll know this or not, but you mentioned when you were talking about medication that things like antihypertensives and antidepressant use amongst pilots have been heavily debated. Particularly with the antidepressant point, I just wondered if you knew what the current status was with that, if that was something that stopped.
It's really quite strict at the moment. I think the current situation is you need to have been off the medication, off the antidepressants for 24 months. And by that, I mean sort of 24 months since you've been classed as okay or like, you know, back to normal again, essentially. And then they're more open to it. That's for the RAF. I think it's slightly different for the Army and Navy, but I'm not 100%. I think it's more just sort of over concerns of anxiety while flying, which is an issue for everyone generally, and that might be exacerbated maybe in flight. Yeah.
Absolutely. That's really interesting. Carol says, thank you so much. What is next for you?
Good question. So I finished my master's and I found that I wasn't overly enthusiastic about going back into education right now. I've basically been in education. I haven't had a break since, you know, I first started, and I'd really just like a bit of a break for now. So I've actually just accepted a job offer with a sort of fitness and gaming company, which I start with on Monday. So I'm just sort of going to give that a bit of a go, and I think it looks really, really fun, and then maybe go back to education in the future. I don't want to rule it out, just need a bit of a break, I think.
Well, that sounds really exciting.
Yeah, I'm excited.
And good luck with the new job.
Thank you.
Mario says, thank you for the wonderful lecture. I'm a physiotherapy student. Do you know what could be done to pursue a career related to aerospace rehabilitation? I saw an MSc degree on your Twitter profile. Is it very expensive?
Sure. So there was actually a physiotherapy student on my master's. The master's is basically open to any sort of bioscience, life science related degree. And physiotherapy would be absolutely fine. Like, she found loads of stuff that was directly applicable to aerospace. I think she did a systematic review on sort of bone and muscle, and we actually had a week at the European Space Agency where we met the physiotherapist and had a physiotherapy session of sort of rehabbing astronauts when they come back from space. So it's honestly an amazing path to pursue. The MSc was, I think it was about 12,000 in the end, covered by the student loan, but I think you can get bursaries or sort of scholarships for that as well. They're not actually running the Space Physiology and Health Masters anymore, but they've incorporated a huge amount of it into the Human and Applied Physiology Masters, which is also really interesting.
Brilliant, excellent advice. Beverly says, do you remember the German Wings accident a couple of years ago? Did this have a certain change to the monitoring of pilots for psychological diseases?
I'm not familiar with that accident. Often when there is an accident, it stimulates a change, but it takes a couple of years for stuff to really come through. I think they've always been quite strict on mental health conditions, but this is actually, as far as I understand, going more the other way and with more sort of understanding and appreciation for the sort of range and breadth of psychological disorders that there are. I think they're actually becoming more sort of lenient and doing it more on a personal basis. But I don't know much about that accident, I'm sorry.
I can't say I've heard of it either. Dan says, I saw King's has an MSc in aerospace physiology and aerospace medicine. What's the difference and which do you recommend? Well, I think you've already answered that by saying you don't want it anymore.
Yeah, so you know, I did the space physiology module, or space physiology master's, and then there was the aerospace medicine MSc, which is actually for doctors that are already qualified. So you've graduated and done your sort of medical degree already. Whereas the space physiology master's, you could sort of intercalate. So Lauren, who spoke in the first week, she'd done 3 years of medicine already and then intercalated for our master's and then is now just gone back to med school. So I guess it sort of depends more on your career. There are sort of niche, subtle differences, but the aerospace medicine course is really like more of like a specialist pathway if you wanted to pursue that rather than an option for intercalation.
That's really interesting. I didn't realize there was two. I didn't know that. That's interesting. That's something I might consider in the future if I can make some money, because I've been a student for like 9 years. Filippo asks, what other career options would you have with an MSc in space physiology or space genetics? Filippo, I believe you were actually at Nina's talk, which should have answered a lot of your questions, but I'll let Maia have a go as well.
I don't know a lot about space genetics, I'm afraid, but I imagine it all sort of encompasses the same idea. Obviously, a lot of people go into medicine, whether that's graduate or just like finishing their undergrad. A lot of people also choose to pursue a PhD. Sadly, at the moment, which is definitely something that I found, these are quite sort of few and far in between. And I personally wouldn't want to pursue a PhD unless I was like really passionate about the topic that was being given to me, which like sadly none of the ones at the moment really appeal to me that much, but that is an option. If you really search for it out there, you can get one, I'm sure. A lot of it depends on your nationality. Sadly, there's not a lot of opportunity for space physiology in the UK. There is with ESA or the European Space Agency or NASA. And if not, I guess just a sort of general research role, if you were just a research assistant. Space physiology is actually way more applicable than people realize to general physiology and exercise physiology and aging and that sort of thing. So it can be really quite broad.
Absolutely. We have another question that's along a similar line. Isim, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, says, thank you for the wonderful talk. I'm an aerospace resident in Turkey. Are there any aerospace residency programs in the UK or PhD programs? I think, like you just said, you need to look for them. As for aerospace residency programs, there is a medical specialization track for aviation and space medicine. Mm-hmm. However, jobs there are very, very few and far between. But I'd certainly, you know, look out for that because it does exist. PhD programs.
Maybe you do it in the UK and go back and hope for the best.
Yeah. For everyone that's asked about career options, I definitely recommend to have a look on YouTube for Nina's talk about how to get into space medicine as a medical student. It's not just applicable to medical students. There's quite a lot there in terms of career pathways, etc., etc. That was packed full of loads of tips and tricks. Yeah. I'm just gonna, before we go any further, there's the link for the feedback form. I encourage you all to fill that in. Maia and I, we're tough skinned, we're big girls, we can take it, please, good or bad, any feedback that you have, we'd love to hear it. There's also a section at the end for you to add your email to the mailing list and also to put your name down for a certificate of participation if you would like. And if nobody else has any questions, which I don't think we do, just lots of people saying thank you and how well you did, which is very well deserved. I think we'll call it a day there. Thank you very much, Maia, for that talk. That was really interesting. And I don't feel bad at all for having asked you to do an aviation medicine presentation. That was brilliant. Honestly, it was excellent. I'm sure everyone else enjoyed. So thank you very much. I'll leave the call open just for another few seconds so that people can access the link. And just a reminder that Eleanor's talk is next Thursday, 7 p.m., same time next week. And she'll be talking about space tourism and a little bit about what the Paraboladies project was that they did when they first formed as a group. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, everyone.